come with us now, if you dare, down a rickety staircase into a dank, dark basement. What awaits? The Saturday Night Freak Show.
Hey there, thanks for listening to the Saturday Night Freak Show podcast. You're wondering what the Saturday Night Freak Show podcast is. As one of our listeners explained, it's like a book club, but for movies, where movies are chosen round robin each week. We watch them, and then we talk about it here for your listening pleasure.
So we're like Oprah's shitty movie club? Is that what...
Hey, give us more credit than that, Sean.
I mean, I pick these movies too, so I'm commenting on myself, but it's like
Oprah's mediocre movie club. Okay.
Oh, I'm having deja vu right now. I've gone through this before.
All right, so here's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about tonight's movie, and then we usually do mail, and then we come back and give you our final reviews on the film.
We usually do mail.
We'll tell you how to mail us.
Yeah, we're at
Facebook.com/SaturdayNightFreakShow.
On Twitter.
@SatFreakShow.
And on email.
Email is SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com.
You guys all jumped the gun. You got to wait for him to say it.
Whatever. They got the information. That's all that matters.
And we would also appreciate it. If you like what we do here, please give us a star rating or a like on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, Sean's favorite, Castroller, or wherever else you found us.
Because whatever you say that, I think you're saying Castor Oil.
Castor oil?
Castor oil.
Oh, castor oil.
Every time you say that, that's what I think you're saying.
Yummy.
Castor oil is missing is a line from Grease, actually. Like the first act of Grease.
All right, so who are these internet radio superstars?
Sean.
Michaela.
Holly.
And I'm Colin. And tonight's movie was chosen by...
Holly.
And Holly, what did we watch tonight?
Tonight we watched the classic film, My Boyfriend's Back.
From the year...
1993.
Directed by...
Bob Balaban.
Who do we know, or how do we know Bob Balaban?
Most of us would know him as an actor.
In the Water? Hello?
I was thinking Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Yeah, oh, that too. Yeah.
Any Wes Anderson movie. Phoebe's dad from Friends.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Was he also the guy who built Hal in 2010, The Year We Make Contact?
Oh,
I never seen.
I don't know.
I have not seen 2010 either.
No.
2001 was enough.
Existed.
He's a classic. Oh, that guy.
So he's probably in that documentary, that one guy from that one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
He's made his IMDb credit says he's done 30 films as director.
You say films.
Good films. You know what? Good for him.
Most of them.
He did like four films.
Most of them were TV episodes. I know various ones were like Oz and Nurse Jackie. There was
Tales from the Dark Side.
Tales from the Dark Side.
Eerie Indiana.
Amazing Stories.
When they rebooted Twilight Zone, he did a couple of those.
Shit, I have that too. And I wonder which ones he did now.
He directed another feature in 1989 called Parents. Which
I always wanted to see that. So Randy Quaid.
Before he went crazy? Gotcha. Okay. I want to know what era of Randy Quaid it is.
Right. It actually
sounds like a freak show movie.
Okay. Are they cannibals?
Yeah. I don't know. I haven't seen it.
That's the mystery.
I'll have to watch it to find out.
Is that one of those Vestron movies? Like, are they coming out with that on the new, now that Vestron Videos, the label's back? So they bringing Parents out?
Probably.
Feels like they should. I keep getting Parents confused with Society. I've always wanted to see that one too. Anyone?
You can pay $30 for the Blu-ray if you'd like.
We talked about that. Didn't someone suggest that for our viewer picks?
Yeah.
I thought so. I'm pretty sure.
Yes.
I think we talked about that
on that list.
There might be cannibalism in that movie too. I'm not sure. I don't know. One day maybe we'll have to check them both out.
It's better if there is.
Okay. So My Boyfriend's Back comes to us surprisingly from the creative team behind Friday the 13th.
That's right.
You're like, what? I'm like, yeah.
What?
This is a Sean Cunningham production.
Yeah.
With music by Harry Manfredini.
We could tell.
Written by the guy, Dean Lurie, who wrote Jason Goes to Hell.
That's right.
And the photography was done by Mac Alberg, who did House, which is also from the people who brought you Friday the 13th.
They had to have lifted the music straight from it.
It's really so similar.
Because it's not even close. It's it. It's the music.
Yeah.
Well, like, it's just at
do
one
you think
point,
Harry Manfredini was like, yeah, here it is.
Yeah.
Here it is. I already wrote this, you know?
I think that's how Harry Manfredini works on most things.
Yeah.
Because at one point he was using like an actual orchestra or a small orchestra and a lot of violins for the Friday the 13th movies. And then I think he actually gave those like on the last two Paramount Friday the 13th movies, there's like, he's got like a co-composer. And I'm like, did you have a co-composer, or that's the guy who actually composed the music to this movie, and they just used some bits of your cues, you know, from the older movies, isn't it?
Probably.
That's like similar thing. So Roger Deakins, who did the principal photography for No Country for Old Men,
God of cinematography.
Yes. So he did like the principal photography for No Country for Old Men, but like the opening shots of No Country for Old Men that are just like still shots of the landscape.
They're gorgeous.
Those were all shot by his interns.
No, no, really? Don't tell us this. This is the man behind
his interns. Kind of did the first shots you ever saw of the best picture winning movie.
I mean, I don't, you are, I'm not so shocked.
So I'm wondering if it's the same situation for this movie, you know, like they did
landscapes.
No, like I don't blame him for doing that, but like, could you imagine being an intern and you scouting the location for,
can you imagine being the intern, you know, and then going to see the movie and be like,
I picked that. Yeah. So I'm wondering if it's like similar thing.
No one would ever believe you. It's like, I shot that.
Sure.
Yeah, you did.
So yeah, Roger Deakins.
Roger Deakins said,
"Good to meet you, Roger."
Yeah, he said all his interns scouted those locations and shot all of them for the intro, where it's just the still shots of the landscape.
Well, you know what that means? He's a good teacher. There,
he's a fantastic teacher, because that looked seamless with the rest of the movie.
Come on, how can you just? You can shoot a landscape and then make it look like Roger Deakins.
It's shutter speed, it's f-stops.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure they didn't just go into like, how does this camera work? What do we do here? I don't know. I'm sure they knew a little something going into it, but interns still, or not.
How do I get a job being his intern?
That's the question
I
want to know.
Hook me up. Yeah. If you know how, please write us and tell me how I can be his intern, because I will gladly.
My family so fast.
Yeah.
To go be Roger Deakins' intern. Yeah. Oh my God.
But I'm wondering if it's the same thing with this movie, that like the interns did the shots you didn't think were done by the principal photographer, you know.
I'm sure somebody's picking up shots here and there. Mm-hmm. Not all, I mean, they're never behind the camera for every single shot that ends up in the movie,
right? Mm-hmm. Exactly. They're Mac just overseeing Elbert, it all.
He was if I remember, he got his start on like Charles Band movies, because I remember famously he shot Metal Storm, The Destruction of Jared Sin in 3D.
You're not allowed to talk about that movie anymore.
And then eventually moved over to working with Sean Cunningham. And I remember there was an interview at one point where John Landis hired him, I think, to do Innocent Blood, or it was something, but he's like, he was like, I have to rescue Mac Elberg from like B movie jail.
Yeah.
It was kind of funny. But Harry Manfredini, though, did actually, I think, do the this is a new score, because I didn't recognize any of these cues from the Friday the 13th movies.
Oh, yeah.
But it's the same instrumentation that he was using. Well, this is 80 or 93, mm-hmm. right? And Jason.
Same year
goes
as Jurassic Park.
Yeah, but he didn't work on that.
No.
But what year was Jason Goes to Hell, the other movie that he did? It had to be like 93, 92. No, yeah, Freddy's Dead was 92. It was like 93, 94?
Yeah,
93. So I was going to say 94.
It was the same year I'm going to go with. And it's like he's stabbing the keys on his synthesizer for this, you know, like.
Yeah.
And it's really bad. And
Jason
was like,
Goes to Hell was 93.
There you go. Yeah, this was like a package same deal music. For somebody.
Yeah.
But this was Touchstone Pictures put this out. You may remember them as an offshoot of the Disney company.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because they had Hollywood Pictures and Touchstone Pictures.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. They had a very notable bump at the beginning of the movie.
Yeah. Isn't that the one where it just kind of goes in? It's the.
That's exactly
the
what it was.
Circle, and then it comes up.
Yeah. Yep.
And then the modern one is the ball that just kind of recedes from the screen. And it's silver. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Touchstone.
We're talking nerd stuff, guys. Yeah. Sorry.
Nerd stuff. You know what we're talking about. You know.
So, openings. My boyfriend's back.
Yeah.
Do you know where this came from? Like, I mean, you heard anything about like how Dean Laurie dreamed up this premise or anything like that?
There's not much information on this.
Dean Laurie makes a cameo appearance in Jason Goes to Hell as a morgue attendant. Is he in this movie? I didn't notice him.
Is he the one who gets killed?
No. Yeah.
Jason Goes to Hell.
Oh, yeah.
Not this
he
movie.
Just goes to hell and doesn't get killed.
Does he get his face put through
through the grate. Yeah, he gets punched into. Yeah.
He that's wants to take a mango sized crap on his mask or something. Like that. That's the writer of this movie.
Yes, thank you, Dean Laurie.
Nice. No, there's honestly not much information on the backstory of this movie.
There hasn't been like an oral history of no. my boyfriend's
Hey, there
back?
Might be at some point.
I doubt
okay,
it. I. You know what? I'm gonna bet. I'm gonna put a dollar on the table on saying there is not any sort of history.
Hey, Renee Zellweger was cut from a scene of this movie, okay?
How do we know that?
She says
According to IMDb trivia.
Yeah.
She shot a full scene in the salon scene. Mm-hmm. She was a girl in the salon that was cut entirely.
Yeah, she had
from
like actual
movie.
Dialogue.
Yeah.
And
if Renee Zellweger admits she was in a movie, we will watch it here on The Freak Show. That is pretty much what we do.
I mean, you guys have watched Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Next Generation,
we
right?
Right? Yeah, she admitted, like, yeah, we did the movie.
Yeah.
And Matthew McConaughey was in this movie, too.
Ooh. That was a shock.
That was a shock.
Ladies and gentlemen, Matthew McConaughey shows up for a shot. It's a shot. It's not even a scene.
Oh, shot. Yeah.
This is his first movie.
It is
his first movie. It is also Matthew Fox's first movie, who's the
Matthew
boyfriend,
Fox.
Buck.
When was Party 5?
96, I think.
95.
His hair grew out a little bit more between this and
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, he did. It did. It really did.
Boy, I don't know why you would go from this to the hair he had in Party of Five. Have you seen that?
Hey, don't hate Party of Five.
I don't hate Party of Five.
Don't hate Party of Five.
Okay.
I love Party of Five.
Yeah, me too.
Time of your life. I was there for all of it, okay?
Okay, all right, all right.
Don't at me, folks. Don't at me.
No, do at him, please.
Don't at
I would love to see
if
it.
You, I mean, if you
it would
find
be,
me,
make some
me.
Great mailbag, wouldn't it?
You at me about Party of Five. Do it.
Say you hate it. Say, I hate Party of Five.
I like Party of Five.
I like
it. It was
Party
a great show, wasn't
That's
it,
right.
though?
Yeah. Damn yeah, straight. Party of Five was great.
It's just like,
Party of Five was 94.
Oh, okay.
So the year before.
So this was what got him the job,
this
clearly.
This was his big break.
In,
right.
Yeah, Party of Five.
Yep.
This was on his demo reel. I can't imagine how that went, but that had to be awesome. Let's see who else we have here in the cast. Tracy Lind, and you're like, who? And I'm like, she was in Fright Night Part 2, and you're like, there was a Fright Night Part 2? Yes, there was.
I might go back and revisit Fright Night Part 2 just for her.
She is a striking young woman.
She is an attractive girl. Yeah. It's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Edward Herrmann is also in the movie.
The amazing Edward Herrmann. Who I'm pretty sure Edward Herrmann has it in his contract that he has to wear a bow tie
every
and everything.
Every movie.
Gilmore Girls, Lost Boys, this movie. That's three
always
in a row.
Bow tie.
That, the
like,
Woody
always.
Allen movies that he's in.
Yep.
I can't remember.
I'm pretty sure
he wears one in Richie Rich.
Oh, he has to. There's no way he doesn't. There is no way he doesn't. Yeah. No.
For sure.
A fun story. I went to a convention and met him once. He was wearing a bow tie at the convention.
Get out.
May he rest in peace.
You met Edward Herrmann?
Sadly enough, I did not spend the money to get an autograph because at the time I did not think it was worth it. Had I known Gilmore Girls and would grow to be what it is now, and he would have died recently later, I would have. But I will say, I was at the bar at this convention. He was sitting at the bar by himself, no handler, nothing.
Oh.
And I was sitting at a table behind him, and I said, bartender, give that man the finest scotch you have. And he sent it to him, and the guy looked over to me and lifted up his scotch and said, thank you, and then drank it, and he was wearing a bow tie. So that's all I need. That's all I need from Edward Herrmann.
There you
go.
Wow.
You know,
awesome.
That's amazing.
Wow.
So I got the best interaction I could hope for from that man. And I will say he, you know, from everyone I know that met him, he was a complete gentleman and loved that the horror community was still behind him for as long as it was.
Sure.
Especially because, like, Lost Boys, by the time I met him, it was a long time since Lost Boys when I met him. So
he's a creepy
But that's guy. What he's like. I mean, in the horror community, that's what he's most recognizable for,
right? And he looked the same, you know, throughout that time.
Yeah,
bow ties, basically. Top to bottom.
Yeah,
he never
did,
stopped
wasn't
he the bow ties.
Person for I can't remember the product now. Was it a computer or something?
I remember
he did these TV
commercials with him in it.
Yeah, on like a white background or something. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm getting it transposed with Mac and PC guys.
No, but he may have done like early, maybe it was Apple. There was an Apple II in this movie. Maybe he did like early
Apple
II. Oh,
that's a tie right in right there. They had a computer in this movie?
What? Yes. was there a computer in this movie?
There was an Apple II sitting on his desk.
In Johnny's room,
there you go.
Yep. What's his name?
Edward Herrmann.
Edward Herrmann.
Right.
Two R's,
two N's.
Well, while Sean's looking that up.
Yeah, we know.
Nerds.
He also briefly mentioned that, yes, the late Philip Seymour Hoffman is in this movie as Philip Hoffman.
Yep.
Is this his first movie?
This is not his first movie, no. He had done something before this, and I can't think of what it was now.
But this is
early.
Twister.
This is early, though.
This is pre-Twister.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a lot
Philip
of this
Hoffman.
Pre-Twister.
This is before he was Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Yeah.
He was just Philip Hoffman at this point,
And J.O. Sanders is in it. That was the sheriff.
The sheriff,
he is known for
lots of
Roseanne.
Roseanne.
He kept on picking on Becky. What did he call her? Maud? It was hilarious. He was like, Dan's best friend or something from the... No?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. Sure, Colin.
Roseanne's coming whatever back, by the way. That's like the biggest news of the hour.
Don't let it happen.
No, don't let it... It shouldn't happen.
Just leave it alone. Just leave it alone. Nobody wants it. It's going to be depressing to see these people.
Let the record show the Saturday Night Freak Show is against that.
Against it.
They did one little thing on The Talk on CBS where Sarah Gilbert was with John Goodman.
And yeah, I saw that.
All right, that's good. That's enough.
Yeah.
It's cute. Just leave it at cute.
Sure, leave it at cute. Leave it at cute. Let's not dedicate
it. Like Holly and I were discussing earlier, what Becky is
going to be? Which Becky are you going to use?
Which Becky are you going to use?
You got to put them both in.
Sarah Trock?
Some way.
I mean, really? They were never
just do alternate episodes, right?
Or they never were never above like commenting on things. They were meta at some points, just talking about.
But that's when it was bad. That's when Roseanne was bad. Was when it was when it was meta.
Are they going to bring back Johnny Galecki?
Yeah, exactly.
Is he back?
Like, they can't afford him. They really can't
afford him.
Yeah. That's right. He's a star of Rings. He'd do it.
He'd do it.
Or a little show called The Big Bang
Theory.
Big
Bang Theory?
Yeah.
A little bit.
And The Star of Rings. I'm just throwing that out there.
Fine. Okay. Is he really Rings?
He did car commercials. He did the Dodge commercials for the longest time.
Shit. Edward like Dodge Ram.
Oh, yeah, my God. Dodge he Ram, did, Durango, didn't he?
Okay, that's what I remember those. Yep.
In a suit and a bow tie.
Yeah. Around the same time, too. 93.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. He's a versatile man.
Mm. I will say, I appreciate that this movie used the Nightmare on Elm Street house.
Yes, that was the house.
And not only is it the Nightmare on Elm Street house, but it's dressed the same way on the outside. Like, it's still got the red door and the pillars. And,
basically. Where's the house sitting? That they
it's in California.
It? Is it on a lot somewhere?
Yeah. It's in California.
It's a street. I think it's it's a residential street.
What?
Yeah. So how do I get to keep using this
Here's
house?
The thing. So a few friends of mine.
The owners are cool.
Yep, the owners are cool. So a few friends of mine have done a few tours of, like, famous... like television movie houses. Mm-hmm. They've gone to the Breaking Bad house, which the lady that owns it is not cool with it. Do not go on her property. She will call the cops on you. Don't do that. The Nightmare on Elm Street lady, very cool. Still red door, still white pillars, everything. The Halloween house looks completely different. It is blue. It's still like structurally the same, but it's painted very differently. It's like blue and it's a dentist office.
It's in Pasadena. It's actually four offices.
Yeah, it's like an orthodontist office or something like that, right? Cool. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like four offices in it right now. And there's actually, last I heard, and this is about a month ago, there's space available in the house.
Let's put some money together and rent it.
Could we just all move to Pasadena and then broadcast the Saturday Night Show to the Halloween
house? Yeah, Freak Show headquarters.
Can we like rent it for a month and then just like all go out there and be like, our special from the Halloween house?
Yeah, I'm just putting it out there. I've got some free time coming up.
There's also a complete replica of the Halloween house in South Carolina.
There's one in Georgia too, isn't there?
There's one in South Carolina that.
Wait, is your friend Sean Clark of Horrors Hell and Grounds?
No.
Who goes around all these places and it's on the shelf?
Charles Cyphers, actually, Sheriff Braggett, told me that there was a. Because, when I met him, I was wearing a shirt that had, like, a picture of the Halloween house on it. And he was like, is that the original Halloween house or is that the one in South Carolina? I was like, well, as far as I know, it's the original one. And he was like, oh, well, in South Carolina, there's a house that's, like, a replica of the Halloween house. Apparently in South Carolina there's a replica, but
and I think the guy does like events at this house.
Yeah, like Halloween events. Yeah, mm-hmm. And the guy that played Michael Myers in like 4, 5, and 6,
George P. Wilbur,
who is from that area, says this house is legit. Go to it, check it out.
Nice.
Anyways, back to this movie. That was a huge detour. Sorry, guys.
So my boyfriend's
I would also like an alcohol.
So this is a movie that is in the zombie subgenre.
Yeah.
Because you're saying, why are we covering this movie? Because it's a romantic zombie comedy.
Yeah, it's great.
We're agreeing on this.
I would say that the lead actor in this movie is like a poor man.
Oh, yeah, we didn't even fucking mention him.
Who Andrew Lowry. He's in School Ties and the Buffy the Vampire Slayer film.
Okay, but he looks...
It's a bad
he's a poor man's...
Tom Everett Scott.
I would say he's a poor man's Andrew McCarthy.
From like...
Bernie? Like a poor man's Andrew McCarthy. Emphasis
Bernie
on the poor man's...
I'll tell you, when I heard that we were watching this movie, I'm like, it's got the guy from American Werewolf in Paris in it, right?
Oh,
Tom Everett Scott. Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean,
but it's not him. It's no. the poor man.
It's like Tom Andrew Everett McCart. Scott and Tim Robbins had a kid. Vaguely look like them.
Andrew, what's his name?
Lowry.
Okay, Lowry. Andrew Lowry. Who playing the character
so
of...
much after this movie.
Mm. Not so much. Not so much. No. Small roles.
Okay, so we say it's a zombie movie because it's about a guy who dies and then comes back from the dead.
Yes. Right.
And then discovers to his horror that in order to like continue to be a zombie, mm-hmm. he has to eat people. But all he really wants to do is take his best girl to the prom.
He just wants to go to the prom, man.
We should mention that when he dies, his mom throws a bologna sandwich on his grave.
mustard.
As in, like, that's a great, great like moment and of, Edward, like, memorialism.
And Edward
Here's
Herrmann.
A bologna sandwich.
Edward Herrmann, be nice to God.
Be nice to God, yeah. As in, like, I know my son won't be in, won't be nice to God. I know he'll be a dick. You know?
That's your first hint that this movie might be a little different as far as how they embrace
that's your
what's
first
going
hint?
On in
Here's
this movie.
A bologna. Bologna sandwich.
It's the first big one, because when, especially you get it big time when he comes back, and they're all like, "Oh, hi, son," and everyone's just like, "I'm glad you're back from the dead."
See,
and all.
See,
and
that's my
the big part.
That's the
that's
best
my
part.
Favorite thing about this movie is how on board everyone is with the absurdity of the premise of this movie.
It makes it absurd to like, what the hell's going on here? Because here's a thing that I was maybe a little confused about. It has these dream sequences where the guy daydreams, you know, and in the daydreams, things are absurd, and you're like, okay, because this is a dream. But then shit happens in the quote-unquote real world that is also as absurd as his dream. And so you're like, at any minute now, the other shoe's going to drop, and he's going to wake up or whatever. But he doesn't. You're like, is this the actual movie? This is really happening? Like, he comes back from the dead, and nobody really reacts to it. They're like, hi, son.
It's kind of fun.
It's like, I'm dead. What
That's
do you
what
want?
I love about it. It's is that fun. No
because
one
it does,
reacts.
It's nice to see that everybody's just like.
Because they're going into it saying, he's a fucking zombie. This can't happen. So all of it's just absurd from the get-go.
That's exactly what I love about it.
Yeah, I love it.
The switchovers are a little, because you're just like, well, if like they're kidnapping people for him to eat in his dreams, why? And they're also doing it in like real life, kidnapping people for him to eat. So like, why is why is it absurd to go into the dream and this happening? And then we go back into this and it's happening.
Right. Why would, I mean, because why the dream is one more supposed to be for levity, right? Because it's absurd, but it's
supposed
like,
to be a change of some sort there.
Right, yeah.
See, but I like that because he's the one having these fantasies where he's like, this is absurd. No one would actually kidnap someone to have me eat them. And then he's like, oh, I'm a zombie. Goes back to real life. And people are actually doing that. Like, he's the only one that's really finding this to be absurd. And that's the hilarious part.
I agree.
Yeah, because it's his fantasy. He knows it's crazy. Like, you can't kidnap someone to have me eat them. But then he wakes up and his mom actually did that. Yeah. And that's hilarious.
My favorite thing about this movie is how on board everyone is with the, like, everyone just accepts the premise of, like, he's a zombie off the bat. That's my favorite thing about this movie.
Well,
like, it's just that everyone, like, keeps going with, with the story, you know?
Yeah, like, when he comes into class and she's like, just because you're dead doesn't mean you can be late for class, and gives him a demerit.
You mean Cloris Leachman, who's in this movie?
No, his teacher. No,
it's
teacher.
Crazy lady later.
Yeah.
Ah, oh, God bless Cloris Leachman.
All right, so then we're going after something else then, right? Like, this is a satire, an allegory for what?
Being a teenager in high school.
And
the feelings that you feel at that time, which are so strong, or you believe they're so strong.
You're going you're through, young your and body is going through changes.
Changes.
That you would come back from the dead for someone, for the girl that you love.
Well, it's the crow or whatever.
Well, this is like could be the more adolescent version of that story. This doesn't get as dark as the crow.
Have you seen Life After Beth?
Yes.
No, have you seen... Well, okay, so I'm talking in the genre of, like, people who are in love with zombies.
Like Warm Bodies.
Warm Bodies is another one.
That's terrible, though. Mm-hmm. That's a bad example.
And Burying the Ex. Both Life After Beth and Burying the Ex, I think, they have the idea of, you know, these are relationships. I mean, it's an allegory for, like, in a relationship that just, you know, you can't get rid of, but it's better if you don't. And, or it's better if you do, and it takes some time to, you know, well, she's dead. You know, Warm Bodies is Romeo and Juliet.
I don't know.
Barely. Barely.
He's like, a kid from the wrong side of the tracks.
But it's
she's
not that smart.
Whose dad is
it's not smart enough to be that. You know, like Romeo and Juliet requires a certain level of intelligence that Warm Bodies never hits. You know, warm bodies, like, is a very surface level interpretation. All right,
so it's West Side Story with zombies.
Yes, it's very much more West Side Story than is Romeo and Juliet. I would agree with that. Yes.
What are we getting after in My Boyfriend's Back?
I don't know.
I will say, okay, so the doctor.
Wait, is it My Best Friend's a Vampire?
Oh, yeah.
That, one's, I like that. That's what this kind of reminds me of. It's kind of the same thing.
A lot of people compare the two. Yeah.
Like Teen Wolf.
Teen Wolf.
We're in the same kind of
area. We kind of hit the every genre. We got vampires, we got zombies, and then we have
werewolves. Well, you have the monster, which is the, you know, it's the whatever.
It is the changing body thing. Yeah, yeah. Just turning into something else. It's the perfect.
I don't feel like myself, but somehow there's like a superpower embedded in there.
Right.
Which his superpower is apparently that.
He can't die.
But he's going to die in 24 hours unless he eats more people in order to survive. His superpower is
and there's
the
girl that kid
of his
with
dreams
the
finds him irresistible.
Yep.
Which that also hit me as like a really like odd tonal shift, because in one scene he comes back from the dead, he goes up to her locker and he's like, you know, will you go with me to the prom? And she's like, I'm dating Buck.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can't. And then in the very next scene, he's taking her out to the movies. And then she's like, I find you irresistible. I'm like, he's dreaming now, right? This is the same, because he had a fantasy about her before.
Yeah.
He's dreaming. But no, she actually does find him irresistible, even as like his ears are falling off in her mouth. So what happened there? Like, where did that like
come from? In this instance, I truly think it's because Buck is very, I mean, we don't get a grand opinion of or a grand explanation of who Buck is, but we get it enough to know that he's probably just kind of a surfacey kind of guy. And she goes on this, and obviously he's very prejudiced against Johnny being a zombie. You know, he's interfering with, what did he say, like good living folk or something like that. You think you can just hang out with us good living folk or something like that?
Yeah.
But he's obviously very prejudiced against Johnny, and she goes on this date with him because she's like, you know, you can't tell me who I can be friends with. I'm going to go out with him because I don't have that shallow side of me like you have. So she goes out with him. And just within the first minutes of being at the movies with him, he's instantly having this moment with her just over snacks. And just like, there's something really great happening right now. Eat this, drink this. And they're just having this really like intimate moment. It seems silly, but it's what teenagers do. And I don't think she ever gets that with Buck. He just probably seems too shallow to have those intimate moments, just silliness like that. And I think that makes him more attractive. I agree that it's very strange that all of a sudden she's very
very attracted like, to a dead guy.
Like irresistibly attracted to a dead guy.
A
I agree with
that's
you.
That's his superpower.
Has very severe makeup. Yeah.
Very severe.
Yeah. Well, he's going gray, and you know pieces are falling off of him, or whatever. They don't do autopsies on everybody, right?
It's no Tom Savini makeup. That's for sure.
True. Yeah. This is one of the very blue zombies.
Yeah.
maybe that's what they're going. Is this a movie about prejudice?
It's not that smart.
A certain level, kind of feels like the way they talk about it, or lay the way Matthew Fox talks about it. Like, you will not associate with us higher class people over here. I mean, there is some.
But that seems like retroactive. You know, it seems like they did it, and afterwards they were like, oh, here we go. Here's the commentary
Not necessarily. If they did it, they weren't doing it as like any sort of serious commentary. I think it's more fun, because I think anything in this movie is just very. Very bubbly, very surface level, just fun. They weren't trying to get too deep on anything.
No,
just fun stuff to poke at.
Exactly. I think that they probably thought, this is a small town, we can run with this. We can run with this conservative mindset. Like, he's the dead guy.
Right,
you know, they
it's
can,
funny.
It's funny, yeah.
That's the point. It's the fact that he's, that the way they're treating him, him being dead is not like a world-altering thing, the fact that he came back to life. It's
and
that
I
he's
love
different.
That. I love that.
Well, that's the thing,
that.
But that's, they're able to make that comment on him and treat him that way, using him being dead as less of him, you know, being a corpse and everything, but just being different
it's,
from them.
It's like the same, it's like the same as if he had like a mohawk. Yeah.
Like that's why everybody, the parents are so chippered, like his son, which is
Edward Herrmann. Yeah.
I love his parents.
His parents are great. His mom especially,
They feel like a 50s era.
Yes.
Yeah, they do.
It was even like in the hairstyles.
They're very nuclear
stuff like
family.
That.
Yeah.
Well, it's the white picket fence street. And,
white picket fence, and there's like a dog.
And,
Which right off the bat, there's a white picket fence and a dog. Yeah.
Blue
Which
velvet.
That's, blue velvet.
Looking behind the white picket fence.
Yeah.
Which that's, I think that's exactly why Bob Balaban picked Mary Beth Hart to play the mom because he used her in Parents in his 1989 movie. And
was it her and Randy Quaid?
It's her and Randy Quaid. And it is set in 1950s. Like, it's those kind of parents. And I think she's playing a very similar character in this. And I'm pretty sure that's why he chose her. Mm. She plays it very well.
Does this movie play kind of like a 1950s era?
In some ways, yes.
Comedy, like
in that like Leave It to Beaver kind of way.
Yeah,
I think so. Like, yeah, the pie on the windowsill. Mm-hmm. He's driving. He's
white picket fence.
White picket fence.
Intro scene in the movie. There's a white picket fence and a pie on the windowsill, like within minutes of each other. Yeah.
Yeah.
But even in the I guess maybe this is my thing. While I was watching it, I was sitting there trying to like listen to the dialogue, not the way it was directed or shot, mm-hmm. which was contemporary 1993.
Yeah.
But I'm like, this is the kind of thing that you were able to get away with in like the B movies of the 50s. You know, it's like this exact plot and the kind of broad humor. I think that, you know, mm-hmm. all the performances are really, really broad. Right?
Yes, very much. But on purpose.
Yeah. That was my point. Oh, okay.
I thought you had a follow-up question.
I was like, that's all I want to say about that. Did you think
a particular character was the Eddie to the Beaver family?
Well, both what's his name? Charlie? Chuck? No.
Chuck.
No, the lead guy.
Johnny?
Johnny. Sorry, Johnny Dingle.
Johnny Zombie.
Yeah, Johnny Dingle. Johnny Dingle. Fucking most generic.
Why do you gotta
ever.
Like? They always
Johnny
do that. They
Dingle,
get the kid who's just like,
yeah, Johnny the Dingle,
dude. They make fun of the entire movie. He's gonna have a last name like Dingle.
Yeah, Dingle.
Dingle.
That's
fucking.
That's not a popular. Yeah, one. Yeah. But both he and Matthew Fox have like their seconds, right? The lieutenants.
Oh yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And that's where they get like the buddy. So the idea cooked up between Johnny and his friend. To win the heart of, what's her name?
Missy.
Yeah.
At the convenience store where mm-hmm. she works, so she'll go to the prom with him, is that the friend's going to wear a ski mask, bust in, try to rob the place with a water gun,
right.
And Johnny's going to protect her valiantly, and because of that noble self-sacrifice, she will want to go to the prom with him.
Flawless plan.
What happens in this scene is that a robber comes in.
Yes.
And shoots Johnny.
An actual, Eddie is unarmed by an actual robber who comes in, and Johnny does not realize that it's not Eddie, and it's someone else under that ski mask who's actually robbing the convenience store.
Yeah. But this does actually, she wants to go to the prom with him after this. At least she says that she does, but when he comes back from the
dead. He's laying there dying. She's like, well, sure, I'll go to the prom with you. You're dying.
Yeah, I don't have to keep the deal.
And when he comes back from the dead, then she has a change of heart for like one scene before she turns around. It's like, you know, I find you irresistible. I don't know. I can't get past this for some reason. But okay.
It is kind of, they just go for it. And there's kind of a, it's liberating to just let things go and what you're going to do in a movie, because to have another robber come up and just be like, you think you're going to rob this store? I'm going to rob this store. And just be kind of like dressed in the same shit that he is and everything, like give me your mask and everything. But they just kind of go for it. There's also like no explanation as to why he comes back. There's just, he just comes back from the dead. I mean, it's because he loves her and he's got to go to the prom and everything.
But I think it's a
supernatural
reason. They explain it later on.
I think they do.
Oh, well, I guess sort of, right. It does get there later. Yes.
Yeah, because this is one of the things through the entire movie. It's just like, well, he just comes back from the dead. And, you know, so it's like, well, does this happen all the time? There's a kindly old caretaker who says, yeah, it happened 15 years ago, which I suppose that character is there just to basically point him in the direction of Cloris Leachman.
Yes.
Whose husband came back from the dead 15 years ago, and she's the one who gives him the information that you have to eat people in order to keep going.
Yes.
To survive. Otherwise, you got to go back to the cemetery. Where apparently you can live out a decently long
time. No, because he's already left the cemetery. Once you leave the cemetery is when you start to fall apart.
You would have had to have stayed there.
Yeah. He's doomed at this point.
How these people know this stuff is beyond me.
It's amazing. Caretaker of the for the cemetery knows these things. Like, he's the wise old caretaker. Like, you just
because if you're hanging around there
long enough,
He's seen it before.
Yeah, but that guy apparently left the cemetery also because his widow, Cloris Leachman, knows that he had to eat people to keep going.
Exactly.
Yeah.
She's like the Betty White in Lake Placid of this movie.
Right. Yes.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Have we
watched that yet?
I'm connecting that dot.
No.
Okay. Well, I'll pick it. Don't worry. I'll pick it.
We shouldn't be looking for logic in a comedy. I realize that. So
no. Especially not in this movie.
Or a zombie movie.
Right. But they also don't like have decided not to care about logic.
I would say, though, that the doctor that like... repeatedly shows up in this movie.
The doctor.
He's the family doctor or something, you know, and the guy initially doesn't want to go to him because, you know, he's dead and doctors will probably have something negative to say about
sure.
that.
Sure.
Yeah.
A prejudice against people. His condition.
Obviously.
And, but when he finally, things are falling off the man, he's got to go to the doctor to get them reattached. And so this becomes like a, probably the B story to the movie, right?
Right, yeah.
Because yes. it's the only stuff that takes place where neither Johnny or Missy
is involved.
Are involved, mm-hmm.
yeah.
Right,
yeah.
So what's going on here? What's the gist of the doctor scenes?
Well,
the B subplot.
The idea originally is he wants to help Johnny. He wants to figure out if he can find a way to help him because he's clearly, I mean, he's the undead. He's not alive, but he's clearly there, and he wants to help him. However, his nurse comes up with this idea. Well, you've made this serum that could save his life, or it could make us a shit ton of money.
Which is exactly what she says. He's like, eh? And so, they cut away from that and be like, what did he decide?
Exactly.
So when he comes and gets him later on, you're like, well, what's going on? Is he going to help him? No.
No, he's going to cut him up for a shit ton of money.
Yeah.
Naturally.
What was the payoff to that? Now I can't even remember how we got out of that plot. I remember
everybody else rushed in, I think.
Because the villagers show up.
The angry mob.
Which is, I think, the first time the angry mob comes to the house, it might be my favorite scene. Because everybody's so very polite about what they want to do.
I love it.
But I love that angle of it. It's just like, well, your son ain't my son today at school. It's like, honey, did you know that Johnny murdered a boy at school today? It's like, oh, no, I didn't know that, dear.
This is Chuck's dad, the boy that Johnny murdered today.
Murdered and ate today. I love that attitude
toward
him.
It's so funny.
He didn't actually murder him. Poor Philip Seymour Hoffman is so fucking stupid with the axe, the fire axe, he accidentally embeds it in his own skull.
Johnny sees an opportunity is all.
I mean, he got that opportunity. You want to take it?
Yeah.
I don't blame him.
I'd have eaten Chuck.
I don't blame him, although his girl and his best friend kind of catch him in the act.
Wrong
of
moment.
People.
You know, wrong place, wrong time. I don't know. I kind of like that it's not a traditional zombie movie where it's like, there's not other zombies being made.
No, that's very
it's
true.
It's just him specific because there's a reason.
Right, yeah. Right. That's what it comes back to is there is a reason why he came back from the
exactly.
dead. People aren't just coming back from the dead at this point.
Right.
Like, he did get bitten, so, you know. Zombie logic would entail that he would like come back.
But he didn't bite him while he was still alive.
True.
This is like Dante's Inferno or something where Beatrice has been taken and like Dante has to fight through all this stuff to get back to his one true love.
Yes.
No, that's not really.
Yes, we'll go with that.
Sure.
Whatever you want it to be, Colin. As long as you laugh at it.
Right. So.
But yeah, the dedication they have to being very calm about the goings on in this movie.
It's what makes it.
It's what makes the movie. Yeah,
that,
it makes it especially different from
exactly.
movies like this.
The tone of the movie is what sets it apart, I think. I really
you have
do.
To like you have to be with it though. You can't just be like,
"Oh yeah.
Why are they people acting like no, you got to be like you have to recognize and be like, "Okay, this is what they're doing.
This is what's all happening."
All right, I'm in.
But you got to go with it.
That might be hard for certain viewers to do.
Certain viewers who don't watch comedies. Colin.
I think, you know.
Comedy Colin.
Yeah. But I can
still. What we call him around here, Comedy Colin. He loves comedy.
I know. It's like kryptonite, right? The comedy.
I know.
Yeah.
It really is. I was discussing this with the guy at work today because, I mean, even he knows that you don't like comedies at this point. Mm. I was meant to ask you why you don't like comedies.
I think, well, this would go toward probably a wrap-up thing, but I think there's something about, and I've said this on several of the other episodes.
Not that you don't like them, you're just like, you're willing to let it happen, but it just doesn't happen, like something to make you laugh.
Yeah, but I always love it when it takes me by surprise, and I like comedies where, I mean, I like dark humor that always like make, you know, because it usually seems like it's a realistic situation where something all of a sudden out of left field happens where like it would in life where it takes you by, you know, unawares. Right.
Yes.
And then it's funny or something, you know, but in movies that set out to be comedy.
Yeah.
And again, I make an exception here for absurdist stuff like Airplane or The Naked Gun or whatever, sure. where it seems like
or
that
top
stuff.
Secret.
Yeah, that stuff works on me.
Yeah,
you know, or maybe, but or, maybe because
what we do
satire.
In the shadows.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, that worked on me. I mean, I thought that was funny, but like for a lot of this stuff, it's like it just doesn't feel like they're real movies because they don't play by any kind of like you know law of any kind of internal logic. It's like that stuff just goes out the window. And you were saying like that zombie movies don't have, but I think they do have like an internal logic to them. It's like they set up rules and then they follow them, right? Mm-hmm. And it's like things happen the way like this is how we would deal with an impossible situation happening, mm-hmm. right? And so you go like, okay, this is an extrapolation of how I suppose the world would react to a zombie apocalypse or how I would react to a zombie apocalypse mm-hmm. or something like that. But in a comedy, like people just accept the zombies, you know, like, oh, you're dead, son. Hey, that's funny.
We'll kidnap a child for you.
And you mom and dad are kidnapping children. It just comes out of the blue.
They love their son. They love him so much.
No matter what.
No matter what. They love their son.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe that's the thing. You know, so the arbitrariness or just the randomness of like, we didn't actually have to sit here and do work to make this thing. It's just we came up with a stream of consciousness. Hey, this will be funny. And right?
Do we need to?
How does it wrap up? How does.
There's a horse.
I want to know.
Theater of the mind right now.
I want to know. Does Johnny get to go to the prom with Missy?
Multiple times.
Oh, it's true. It kind of does.
This is the ending that like resolves like or
he goes as a dead guy.
He came back.
Yes, and then he escapes from the doctor who has decided that money is more important than saving him. He escapes. Missy and Eddie take him to the prom where he gets one last dance with Missy and then actually dies on the dance floor.
A little sad. He gets
it is a little sad. She's crying. Like, it's sad.
And then he dies.
And then he's greeted at the pearly gates by an angry judge because he's late. He was supposed to be there four days ago.
But they also made a mistake.
Someone fucked up. The robber was supposed to slip on coffee. And he wasn't actually supposed to die.
And at this moment, this explains how there is a zombie in this movie.
Yes, because
it happens occasionally.
Occasionally, something slips through the cracks, and Johnny's given a second chance.
Yeah.
To show what he's going to do with his second chance, and that'll determine what happens in his afterlife.
So the message, it's a message movie. This is an after school special. I'm sorry. So he has to, as long as he's a good person in his acts, then he will go through the pearly gates.
Essentially, but he's instead sent back to be a boy again.
Right. Well, moments before
the deciding event, yes.
Yep.
Of him being shot. And he still makes the same decision.
Yeah. He still makes it. He's still going to save Missy's life, even though he knows.
Because he loves her.
Because he loves her. But he doesn't actually die.
No, he gets shot in the pendant.
The bullet hits the locket that he was always going to give her since they were babies.
Oh, that makes it sound creepy.
whatever.
Okay.
There was some like almost slightly creepy moments, like, but he's in love, but so I guess we'll let it pass.
But he didn't cross that like threshold.
Right. There's a line. He's like, he stayed on it.
Yeah.
He like straddled that line.
Yes, he did.
The whole movie.
He got there. Yeah. It's like, oh look, there's that line.
Yep.
I'm gonna talk about it.
I'm gonna walk by it.
I might tiptoe over it, but I won't cross it.
I'm gonna talk about that line.
So in the end, Johnny lives. Missy goes to the prom with him. They're in love, and they live happily ever after.
Do they? Because I'm imagining like a year later, it gets really awkward, and it's just like, well,
hey, no one asked a year later on Escape from L.A.
That's right.
Hey. No one asked a year later from Escape from L.A.
You made out with Jessica last night, and I don't love you anymore. And then mm-hmm. shit could have gone wrong for these people.
Oh, yeah. Well, something's got to be done about their kids.
Yeah.
No.
Do they turn into assholes or something?
How could they not be assholes at this point, right?
There it is.
All right, so
I think that's my boyfriend's back.
My boyfriend's back.
I think so.
Right now, listener, we are encouraging you again. We would do mail, but we don't have any this week. Nobody wrote in about our past episodes or this one.
I agree, Wolf.
Yeah.
We want to know what you thought of My Boyfriend's Back, this episode, or any previous one we have done.
Poor Igor.
I know, right? We're never going to have to beat him.
He's on the tire swing doing nothing.
We're going to have to beat him.
That's not a tire swing. It's one of those shitty, like, just wood plank swings where you're just like...
Yeah.
Well, if we were going to call for Igor, and if we were going to read mail, how can people get a hold of us? Probably on Facebook.
Facebook.com/SaturdayNightFreakShow.
On Twitter.
@SatFreakShow.
Or by email.
SaturdayNightFreakShow@Yahoo.com.
So there you have it. So we're going to do wrap-ups. We're going to go around the room. You're going to find out what we really thought of My Boyfriend's Back. There's four of us. How many of us will love it? How many of us will hate it? Nobody's going to hate this movie, right?
Maybe we should start with the first guy, Colin.
Oh, shit, it's me. I'm up
what
already.
What did you think of My Boyfriend's Back?
This was one of the hardest experiences to watch a movie that I've ever... I hated this movie.
Oh, my God, it hurts.
Oh, yeah, this was rough.
There should be, like, certain quotes that are on our wall.
And that's one of them.
Of, like, just... That is definitely should be one of them. It's like, I hated this movie.
I hated this movie.
That probably Roger applies Ebert to some movies you picked, too.
At one point, hated your movie or something.
Yeah, I hated your movie.
Yeah, it was really rough because I think you look at it... I take a movie apart when I try to do, like, an assessment of it. I'm like, okay, so how was the script? Sometimes the script is good, sometimes it's bad, but, there's things that balance it out and make up for this. The script in this case was awful. I'm like, who was this fucking movie made for? It was tone deaf. The comedy was, like, just weird. It was like, this doesn't make any goddamn sense. The jokes all fell on their face. It was just the whole thing was terrible. And I was trying to think of it like as like a bad 50s movie, like the giant Gila monster, something like that, or Killers from Space, or one of these like really bad 50s movies, like
giant octopuses running.
Yeah. If you would have made this in the 50s with this exact same script, Leave It to Beaver by way of, My Boyfriend's Back is a Zombie.
They do make this as kind of a 50s game. It's called The Deadersons.
I commend you for willing to stand up for that local burn.
Yeah. So maybe the acting is fantastic. The acting, to be honest, I didn't have a problem with anybody, any of the performers. They were
not
all,
even Philip Seymour Hoffman?
No, because he was doing a character bit based on what he was, the direction he was getting from the director. Right. I fault the
then
director.
He was 12 years old in this movie. Yeah. Like, he had to have been.
I fault Bob Balaban 100%. I'm like, this guy, this was a terribly directed movie. I thought, spatially, I'm aware of where I'm at. But
right,
as far as calibrating a performance, and this guy's an actor. Right? You should understand actions.
You should have an edge.
But these are so broad. I mean, like, it's so broad. It's totally inconsistent. It was just like, the photography is okay, Mac Elberg. I'm going to give you credit. And Harry Manfredini's score is the worst thing I've ever heard. And it actually makes you sit there and go, like, I like those Friday the 13th movies. But after watching this, I'm like, those guys don't know what they're doing. They really did luck into something, but they are not professional filmmakers. They... especially by the time you get to Jason Goes to Hell, it's like that's the one of the worst, if not the worst, of the Friday the 13th franchise. And this was made around the same time. And I'm like, you guys have been making movies for like 20 years, at least by this point.
You don't
got to
get better.
You're not getting any better.
You don't got to get better.
Yeah. And so, yeah, you're calling into question my affection for the Friday the 13th
series. Ooh, damn. That's how much he doesn't like this movie. Yeah. It's affecting a different franchise.
Yeah. It was really, really bad, folks. I mean, I know, we're going to go around the table and everybody's going to tell you it was hilarious and they loved it and they've got a soft spot for it.
All right, Travis.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Because, you can like what you like and you can make a case for it.
And you can like what you like and you can be wrong, but this is how I feel about it.
To me, well, you might be right. You could be wrong. This could be like one of the worst movies ever made. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah.
It could be.
Give this one a wide berth. I mean, run away from My Boyfriend's Back. That's my review there. Sean.
All right. My Boyfriend's Back. I do have an affinity for movies from this era, or even maybe from earlier, where they kind of deal with the situation. I do find the movies, it's the coming of age, the young teens are always going through some situation, that young teens go through. But like we talked about earlier, how there's always some like added extra element to it, whether you're a zombie or a werewolf or a vampire. I grew up watching these movies, and I find entertainment in them. There is definitely some not so great things about this movie, but I like the things I do like about it is like their dedication to it just being like, "Hey, my dead son came back," and I found it. I still found it funny. I haven't seen this movie in a long time, but I did find parts of it funny. It didn't do anything wrong for me, I think. Yeah, I mean, I think I might still recommend this movie. Like, I know Colin's going to be befuddled by this for some reason, but there's still enough to this where I have
There's no accounting for taste.
There really isn't, because there's...
You're right, because we saw Dune a few weeks back.
There's just some shit that you're just like, you like, and there's not much you can say about it. And the movies like this, I do like watching, and I still enjoy them. I'd recommend My Boyfriend's Back. Michaela, what did you think of My Boyfriend's Back?
Okay, so this movie had like a lot of great 90s tropes. I think it worked in a lot of things nicely. It had like a 90s version of Andrew McCarthy, you know?
Yeah.
Being your lead guy.
It had the 90s music and titles at the beginning.
Yeah.
Who wants the soundtrack album?
Yeah. Hey, Weisberg Records / Mondo, please put out...
I don't know if that'd be a big seller.
What? You don't think My Boyfriend's Back wouldn't be a huge seller?
So. Secretly, you are on my side on this show.
Here's the thing. The reason I think that it would not be a good seller is because people would expect the title track to be My Boyfriend's Back.
Oh, shit. We didn't remember.
By
that.
The Angels. Yeah, and that song is not even in this movie.
Not even.
That was a missed opportunity.
Low budget movie.
Yeah.
Oh, that's unfortunate. It would have to be. Like, that's the only reason anybody would buy it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I will say I did appreciate the pajamas that said, I'm tired with rubber tires. Throwback to our rubber episode. Please go check it out if you haven't listened to it yet.
Rubber.
That was like, my second or third pick for the freak show.
We had a good time on that one.
Yeah. Yeah. It was great because there was tires all over his pajama pants. Yeah, they said that. The thing I liked about this movie is that everyone was on the same wavelength of insanity. Like, everyone was, like, willing to accept that he was dead and, you know, come back for whatever reason.
Right. They're all on the same plane of existence.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like, this is what happened.
Yeah. This movie, everyone was on the same plane of, like, okay, sure, whatever. We'll accept whatever's thrown at us.
Years ago.
Yeah.
Cloris Leachman, believe it or not.
Yeah. No matter what caliber of actor you were on the same wavelength of, this is insane, but whatever, we'll roll with it. So I would definitely recommend it because it's a fun 90s romp. Like, if you're expecting anything other than that, don't watch this movie. But
yeah.
But it was a good movie for exactly, it delivers on exactly what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Come for the zombies, stay for Tracy Lynde.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, come for the Sean S. Cunningham directed movie and stay for the Henry Manfredi score, you know?
Plop in there.
That's why everyone's here, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's why everyone's
here. That's the only
reason
we're here.
So, Holly, what'd you think?
Well, I obviously picked this movie because...
You own it on Blu-ray.
I own it on Blu-ray. And it's no secret, I love this movie so much. I've been watching it since I was... Well, probably since 1993. And... It still holds up to be hilarious to me. I we've all said it. They all know exactly what this movie is that they're making. They all know that it's silly. It's ridiculous, and they all know that, and they all play to that, and that's the point of it. And I love that that's the point of it. It's a different take on a zombie tale. You know, it's not your typical zombie movie, but it is a zombie tale, and I love that. And it's one of those that it brings these elements together that don't normally go together in a movie. It is a romantic comedy. It is a black comedy. It is a zombie movie. It's all these things put together in a 90s teen movie. And I think that's just a fantastic combination. It wouldn't always work. I know that it doesn't necessarily work for everyone, but I think in this it does work. It's hilarious. It is in its ridiculousness.
His arm's off on the cover.
Yeah, his arm. He's holding his arm, which is holding flowers on the cover, and that's fantastic.
Come on, Colin. That's funny.
I do understand why Colin doesn't like this movie, because it's not a movie for Colin.
No,
you know, this is true.
I get that. I totally
or
get
audiences.
That.
I mean, sorry.
Colin!
I know.
Colin!
People that are alive.
Colin.
I'm sorry. You were
sorry. Don't apologize for the way you feel about a movie.
No.
I'm intruding on her rap.
He's intruding.
Okay.
And I never insult audiences for liking your movies, Colin. Ever.
It was a cheap shot.
It was.
I'm shamed. Shamed. I'm feeling shame right now.
Wait, what is it? We just circle him. Shame.
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 Shame. Shame. Shame. I love that movie, too. But anyway, sorry. Throwback to what we do in the shadows. But yeah, this movie is what it is. It's not for everyone, but for anyone that would like a movie like this, they're going to enjoy it. It's going to be exactly what they're looking for. It's hilarious, it's fun, and I definitely recommend it for anyone that is looking for a lighthearted movie like this. Yeah, zombies, romantic comedy, black comedy. It's great. I definitely recommend. There yeah.
All right, so that's the last we'll hear of My Boyfriend's Back on Saturday Ever. Night Freak Show. Next week, we're going to watch a movie that's chosen by...
Michaela.
Michaela, what are we going to watch next week?
Oh, God.
Okay, guys, we're kicking off summer here. And we're going to take a tour through the summer of canon films. The canon of canon, if you will. And we're going to start off.
We see what you did there.
We're going to start it off with a classic called Over the Top.
Yeah.
Next week, we're going to start off with Over the Top.
Stallone.
So,
love it.
That just means you can't ever pick Cobra.
I know. I'm never going to get to Cobra.
Never get to Cobra.
Yeah. I should have done it last year.
Maybe I'll pick Cobra.
On the anniversary.
You've had how many years, Colin?
There's so many movies.
It's in my zeitgeist right now, and I must talk about it with off the mic, but I'll never pick it.
Well, we kind of had that one episode. I don't even remember what the hell it was, where we talked about Cobra.
We talked about Cobra a lot. Yeah.
We did.
What was that?
Was it
Demolition Man?
No, I think it was, ironically enough, it was a different episode that we talked about Cobra.
Yeah, it might have been another cop movie.
It's okay. We'll watch Cobra eventually. If nothing else, I'll pick Cobra at some point. So.
Well, yeah, no. At some point, it's on.
God knows it wasn't the Metal Storm episode.
It's the summer of canon. Guys, it's the summer of canon.
Summer of canon.
We've already done Masters of the Universe. Damn. Okay, so until next week, then, the basement is going dark.